Archbishop, ladies and gentlemen, those of us who believe in not tampering with a definition of marriage that has survived for millennia and is recognised across the globe have been called bigots. You know, that's very strange, as some of the opposition to redefining marriage is actually coming from homosexuals themselves. For example, Andrew Pearce, a gay columnist for the Daily Mail, has written persuasively of his opposition to the change, while Christopher Biggins has said that, of course, a marriage is between a man and a woman. Are these, and the many gays that share those views, bigots? Are they homophobic? Simply articulating a recognition that redefining marriage is wrong. As has been pointed out many times, redefining marriage will not give gays a single right which they do not already have in civil partnerships. But it will take away the right of a wife to call herself that in law, and the right of a husband legally to describe himself as such. Stonewall has suggested that instead of using husband and wife, we should instead replace them in the Matrimonial Causes Act with the soulless term parties to a marriage. How is your party to a marriage? Is she better? And as the Archbishop has pointed out, that will be capable of extremely wide interpretation. And as Colin Hart pointed out, is already being widely interpreted in other countries which have gone down this route. For how many parties to a marriage can you end up with if that is your definition? The word marriage appears over 3,000 times in UK legislation. The word husband, 1,000 times. Wife, about 900 times. And the phrase husband and wife, some 350 times. So any change is unlikely to be a simple matter. It's likely to take up rather a lot of time. And many of us would say we've got plenty to do without that. Not to give a single extra right to anybody. So are we being alarmist? Well, consider what has actually happened in those countries where the definition of marriage has been changed. Changes haven't just been limited to husband and wife, but in the Netherlands, even mother and father have been replaced. So, we imagine. Johnny, can you tell us, please, what your progenitor A does? It is not remotely sensible. It is not remotely wise. It is not something that, when people understand the implications, very many people even want, and it certainly isn't something that they want any government to give a priority to. Is it bigoted to question the wisdom of that? Is it bigoted to recognise that the complementarity of a man and a woman in a union open to procreation is unique and cannot be replicated by other unions. The real bigots, those who really deserve to be described as such, the real extremists, the real nasties, are those who believe that those who dissent from their view have no right to do so and that the state itself should silence them. Society can be free without the freedom to dissent, and no democracy real without the recognition of a plurality of views. Yet hear what the leading human rights lawyer, Aidan O'Neill QC, has to say about that precious freedom, should this measure actually be passed into law. Hear it, David Cameron. And tell me how a party devoted to freedom, a party that has always opposed oppression and the power of the state over the individual, can even contemplate creating such a Britain. Here is the picture, and it's only a very small portion of the picture, that Aidan O'Neill, QC, human rights lawyer, actually paints. Consider the position of an NHS chaplain who is also a vicar. And he preaches in his own parish that marriage is only possible between a man and a woman. He can actually be sacked as an NHS chaplain. Consider a teacher who does not want to teach gay marriage. That is not, she doesn't want to teach tolerance, she doesn't want to teach marriage. She can face dismissal. A couple applying to be foster carers happen to say to the social worker that they're doing this because they believe that every child has the right to be brought up in a stable union with a mum and dad where possible. And on hearing this, they're immediately asked if they support gay marriage. The couple say no. May not be a matter of faith, because for a lot of people it isn't. They just say no. The opinion of Aidan O'Neill is that a local authority would have legitimate grounds for refusing that couple as a foster parents. Consider the use of public facilities. A church hires a council-owned community centre each week for the use of its youth club. The church website states that it will only conduct opposite-sex marriages. So someone complains to the council, and no, the church can't be forced to carry out gay weddings, but it can be told that it may no longer use the community centre. And then consider, as we already have, the position of the established church, the Church of England, for the establishment of which I, though a Roman Catholic, would die in a ditch. I sometimes think that the people I wouldn't find in the ditch beside me are the hierarchy of the Church of England. But we've got a jolly good exception to that here today. The position of the Church of England being the established church is that it must marry those who require it and against whom there is no lawful impediment. And so probably, according to Aidan O'Neill, the only way that the church could absolutely guarantee not marrying people of the same sex would be if it were to be disestablished. Is that really what we want from what looks like such a simple little measure? It is not simple at all. It is very dangerous. I know you, David Cameron, and I know that this is not the sort of Britain that you want. So drop this measure now. Well, consider what has happened already in this country before we've even got the measure through. A registrar dismissed for changing her shifts with perfectly willing colleagues to avoid conducting civil partnerships. Christian bed and breakfast owners taken to court for refusing a double bed under their own roof to homosexuals, despite having exactly the same policy towards unmarried heterosexuals. A children's author quizzed by police, after saying she did not support homosexual adoption. Roman Catholic adoption agencies forced to close. And don't forget the housing official from Trafford, who was demoted for saying on his personal Facebook site that he thought gay marriage a step too far. It has been the hallmark of totalitarian states down the ages that both... Is that how we really want Britain to look in the 21st century? Is that really the vision of the Conservative Party? That nobody who believes in a definition of marriage honoured in the overwhelming majority of the world, regardless of the prevailing creed or the prevailing political system, shall be able to be a printer, a website designer, a guest house owner, a teacher, a housing official, a registrar, an NHS chaplain, an adoption worker, a foster carer, to name just a few of those that will be affected. Of course, as I once pointed out in the House of Commons, MPs are free to speak their minds. They can mount whatever arguments they see fit, but the people they govern are no longer free to speak their minds. Is that. But when the gags are taken off by the anonymity of opinion polls, the public speaks loudly and clearly. In a recent poll, 86% said that it is possible to be tolerant of the rights of others and protective of traditional marriage at the same time. And in poll after poll, a majority of respondents have opposed redefining marriage. It isn't just opposed gay marriage. This is not an anti-gay rally. It is defining marriage full stop. The Coalition for Marriage petition has attracted a record 602,222 signatures, which may have gone up even as I've been speaking. And that is about three times as many as ever achieved by anything on the Downing Street website. So let us stand up to the bigots. Let us defend marriage. Let us work for a free society, because there was a time when no Conservative would ever have done anything else.